Hi guys, I hope you will be fine. Today the topic which I am going to discuss is about the insect's mouth parts. Mouth part, that is a comprises an intricate toolkit for feeding, specialized for feeding apparatus. There are many variations in mouth parts regarding structure, function, and in insects there are multiple or several kinds of feeding modes. Broadly, it is grouped in two categories: mandibulate, biting and chewing, and haustellate, that is the sucking mouth parts. Mandibulate, generalized chewing, and mandibulate mouth part represent the most primitive and least specialized type. Haustellates evolve as an adaptive radiations. Mandibulate mouth part consists of the several components. It consists of anterior upper lip or the labrum and the hypopharynx, a pair of mandibles, a pair of maxillae, posterior lower lip of the labium. These are the relevant parts of the mandibulate mouth parts. Labrum is the suspended form above, articulate with the clypeus by thin membrane, and the clypeus, which is the clypeus I already discussed in the previous lecture. The epipharynx valve form the roof of the preoral cavity. Epipharyngeal valves bears a lobes and the extensions called the hypopharynx. That hypopharynx function as a tongue. The portion of preoral cavity which is presented between the hypopharynx and the labrum is called the cibarium. That is the part of the preoral cavity and located between the hypopharynx and the labrum, it is termed as the cibarium. And another part of the preoral cavity which is also located between the hypopharynx and the labium, this is called the salivarium. In both parts, there is a cibarium and the salivarium, and the hypopharynx is the common. Here are represented in the more precise way. This is the anterior part, this is the posterior part, so this is the labrum, it is the upper part, this is called the hypopharynx. The part between the labrum and the hypopharynx is called the cibarium. In the cibarium, mouth is located. In the cibarium, mouth present here. And the part of the other preoral cavity which is located between the hypopharynx and the labium, this is the hypopharynx, this is the labium, termed as the salivarium. And in the salivarium there is the opening of the salivary glands. Mandibles, pair of well developed, highly sclerotized mandibles or unsegmented jaw, mandible represented jaw. This each mandible articulated with the cranium, there is a brain case, there is a skull case, and two points articulation, there is the movement between this of the mandibles at the two points. Each mandible has a proximal, there is a basal grinding region termed as the molar. You know, like the humerus, molar represent for the sake of the grinding. In this way, the mandible's proximal part is also represent and also used for the grinding and the crushing of the prey. Distal cutting region is called the incisor, which is a chisel like our, which is a very sharp end. In predaceous beetles and the ants, mandibles elongates. These mandible elongated structure, this is responsible for the grasping structure. This is well adapted for catching and holding the prey. And the represented here are in the male dobson flies, well-developed, impressive mandibles are responsible for holding the female during the copulation, during the mating process. In the eastern dobson fly, represented here, this is a very elongated structure, and these structures are used for grasping or holding the prey, not only the prey, but also holding the female during the process of mating. And in the predaceous beetle, same structure as mandible as here. These are three pairs of jointed appendages, which is a very important character of the insects. This is the mandibles, which is a very impressive structure. And in the pollen feeding and the dung beetles which feed at the fecal material of the cattle. buffaloes, cows. Mandibles are more or less flattened. They serve to mold dungs or the pollen into the small pellets of the balls. Because this is responsible, they form a small pellets, small ball-like structure to form into the ball of the dung. They use their mandibles. Look here into the this animation is represented here. This is the formatting of ball-like structure, and this is further the molding, and the further molding is they use their posterior legs. They roll on the grounds to form our round balls. There is a mandible they're using to shape the mold of the dungs. Maxillae or maxilla, singular. Pair of maxillae occupy lateral position behind the mandible. It is a serve as accessory jaws. This accessory jaws is helpful in aids in the holding chewing food before being ground by the mandibles. Before it reaches to the mandible, these hold and chew foods. Each maxilla, when we look into the structure of the maxilla, each maxilla composes a proximal part which is called the caudal, which bears stapes. Proximal part caudal, it has a stapes, and that stapes bears the two distal lobes, which is outer lobes called the galea, and inner is called the lacinia. Galea and lacinia, these are two parts, and the two lobes of the stapes. Galea shield the lacinia. Shield, there is a cover when insects are feeding. When insect is resting condition, it is not involved in the feeding, then this galea hides the lacinia, cover the lacinia. Here the structure are represented here. This is the insect maxilla on the one side. This is the caudal. This is the proximal part. And this is the stapes. This is another part. And the stapes is the two lobes. This is called the lacinia. This is called the galea. This is two parts. This is the two parts of stapes. Stapes bear lateral sacrilides. And stapes, this is a stapes, it bears the, because it is represented from the one way, here sacrilides is not represented, which is called the palpiform. Later sacrilides are called palpiform, which have a five segmented maxillary pulps. These maxillary pulps are palpi, are sense structures. What function they will be performed? They are used to test the quality of the food. Because they check whether this food is being eaten or not. They have to check, they have to recognize, they have to realize. But this is sense structure. A maxillae used to scratch the food. This scratching the food, cleaning and chewing, and the forelegs, all these are the functions. And other structure, which is called the labium, it is also a very important part of the mouth. Labium corresponds to the maxilla. It has the basal postmentum. That basal part is called the postmentum. This part is attached to the cervix. Postmentum transversely divided into the following components. One of them is called the proximal submentum. This is the proximal sub. This is the proximal part. This is the proximal submentum. This is the division of the R. Is the division of the postmentum. And postmental transversely where it divide, it is called the submentrum. This is a terminal part, is called the submentrum. And the distal end is called the mentrum. This is called the mentrum. Proximal part, mentrum, submentrum. This is called the distal part called mentrum. Apical region of the labium is a premantrum. Apex represented the premantrum, which is the hinge to the postmentrum by a labial suture. This premantrum is connected. This premantrum, which is a hinge to the postmantrum, this is a postmantrum by labial sutures. Labial sutures, the sutures are hinge-like structure, are the bones of our skull, and they have the ridges. These ridges are fixed the bones with one another, like that they have also the sutures, which fix the premantrum with the postmantrum. Premenstrum, beers and other structures appear a literal three-segmental labial palpi, labial pars, which have three segmented and distally four lobes. Here, or you can represent it here, this is a labial pars, which has a three segments, 1, 2, 3, you can calculate here, there's a pair structure. And the distally, and this is the distal part, and four lobes, distally four lobes, two inner lobes, and the two outer lobes. Two inner lobes are called the glossa or glossi, located between the two outer paraglossi. Inner, located between two paraglossi. Here are the four lobes. This is the outer, the paraglossi. Labial palpi are attached to the lateral sacroiliacs on prelabium, the palpigers. Palpigear structure is not represented here, it is represented in the next slide. I will tell you again. Palpi mainly sensory function. This is a mainly sensory structure. This is called the palpigear, which is structure of this one, labial palpi, which is located at the mentrum. This is called, it is a sacroiliacs, it is a sacroiliac plate, which is called the palpigear. Hypopharynx. Hypopharynx is the median lobe placed immediately behind the mouth. This is behind the mouth. Commonly, salivary ducts open behind the hypopharynx. Between the hypopharynx and the labium, this is the common salivary ducts which pour its saliva into this structure. This is a hypopharynx. Generally, it is a membranous structure. It is not so tough structure, but is a aboral phase, generally or distally sclerotized, which is a sclerotized. It and other structure of the mandibulate mouth parts are cockroach is represented here. As you can check here, all part which I have explained earlier is represented here in this slide. Hostilate mouth parts. Hostilate mouth parts. That is the sucking or the hostilar mouth part represent advanced and specialized mouth parts. In most cases, they are homologous with the generalized mouth parts. These are adapted for various types of the sucking activities. When insects are going to suck the different types of foods, they are modified for various types of the foods. Further classification. There are further hostilate mouth parts are further classified in two major categories. One of them is stylate, other is called the non-stylates. Stylates, which is called then generally and commonly we call the syringe. Syringe is like to penetrate in the body. In this part, the mouth, insects the mouth parts, which is like the syringe, they are responsible, they are used to penetrate in the host tissues. Whether animals or others. This is also called the piercing, sucking and the rasping suckings. Are included in this part. And the non-stylates represent chewing lap, chewing, lapping, spawning, and the siphoning mouth parts. Now we are going to discuss about the detail of these stylates mouth parts. Characterized by the presence of stylates, that's the syringes, which is a sword like, the needle like structure, this is a modification of one or more of the generalized mouth parts. General mouth parts are collected, combined, fused to form a stylate, a needle-like structure. Stylates may be formed from a combination of one or more of the mouth parts and the hypopharynx. It is also formed, stylates can also form. It is used to pierce or at least abrade plants, that is scratch plants or animal tissues. This is also used for the piercing, for the penetration, or the scratching. And like this, we have the mobile card, and we show its number by the scratching with the nails. Like this, they use their mouth part to scratch the tissues. Feed of the fluid exude or the pump from the host. From this scratching, the fluid which comes out, used. They are these mouth parts responsible to feed on that excreted fluids or they pump that fluid into their body. Non-stellar most parts, they do not possess stylus, they are not strange. Example, there are the butterflies, there are the moths, non-biting muscular flies. Many higher hemineptrons, which is commonly includes bees, wasps, ants, etc. These insects do not penetrate into the tissue of the host of the plants or the animals, feed on the exposed fluid, which is exposed, which is not into the vessels, which is not present deep into the body. So these are the suck on those material which is exposed, which is naked. Chewing are the lipping mouth parts. It says for the types of the sucking mouth parts. One of them is the chewing are the lipping mouth parts. Second one is the rasping are the sucking mouth parts. Third one is the piercing are sucking mouth parts, sponging mouth parts, and the siphoning mouth parts. So these are the five different types of mouth parts which we discuss one by one. Chewing are the lapping mouth parts. More advanced hemineptrons insects have labrum and the mandibles resemble found in the chewing insects. These two parts resemble this, the parts of the labrum and the mandible. It is a similar structure which is present in the chewing insects. Maxillae and the labium unite to form a sort of the lapping structure. They have two structures are combined, two structures are fused, which one of them is the maxilla and the labium. This is a structure which is unite to form a lapping structure. Examples, honeybees and another, there is the elongate glossy of a labium form a tubular parts of this structure, well adapted for thrusting into the floral nectaries. Nectaries that is called the honey of the flowers. They depends at the nectars of the flowers by elongate glossy of the labium. Here represented here, labium, glossy of the labium. This is the elongated structure which is responsible for the lapping. This is put into the nectars of the flower and from the for the suck the nectar. Nectar is the food which is a very rich nutritious food. Next one is rasping are the sucking mouth parts. In thrips, mouth parts are cone-shaped beaks. This is the cone-shaped beaks. You know, thrips is the insects, is the parasites, external parasites of the plants, of the cotton, and other plants like that. It is not depends upon the animals for feeding. This cone-shaped beaks is formed by the clypeus, which I already discussed with you. This is a clypeus. This is a labrum, and other part is called the. This is a labrum. This is the labrum, and the parts of the maxillae. This is the right maxilla. This one is the left maxilla, and the labium. This is called the labium. This is labium. All collectively form the cone-shaped beak of thrips. The beak contains maxilla, a maxillae, both maxillae, right and left one, hypopharynx. This is represented by the hypopharynx and the left mandible, not the right mandible. This is represented by the left mandible. It is also part of the cone. All together form a stridus. All together, they form a syringe-like structure. Thrips use beak to rasp host, rasp like a file. When we cut our nails, then we rasping with the file. Scratching. In this way, they're rasping at the tissues of the plants and take up the liquid food through the stylets, and from due to this rasping, this is scratching, the fluid of the plant tissue excreted out, then they suck this food with the help of their stylets. This type of the mouth part is a primitive form of the piercing sucking types. In piercing at the sucking mouth parts, in most sucking insects, This cerebellum has become modified to function as a pump. Pump, you know, pump has a pump to take another food with a suction mechanism. They can suck, there's a mouth part, the mouth part is in such a way, they are responsible to suck the food. Examples. This type of the mouth part represents the dithyrans, that is the flies, Hemiptera, are the true bugs, Siphonoptera, there's a flea. The pharyngeal region also commonly formed a pump, for example, piercing sucking mouth parts in this way. Adult mosquitoes, dithyrans, represented one example from the dithyra are the that is the mosquitoes. It is a well-known example. How mosquito bites, how mosquito pires, how mosquito style is injected into the body of the host, how mosquito can suck the food, how mosquito, I can tell you here, how mosquito recognize where is the blood vessel and which is the appropriate place where they have to penetrate the stylets. Which parts of the mouth are mosquitoes involved in this process? I can tell you all these things. And the saliva sting. One thing I want to clear here, the stylets are two major parts. The one part which pours saliva into the host tissue, the host blood vessel. Other part of the stylus, which is a pipe-like structure, which is responsible to suck the blood. From the one, they pour the saliva into the blood vessel, and other they suck the blood. Because the saliva of the mosquito have the anticoagulant material, which cannot coagulate the blood. So, and other structure which is called the irritating structure, which is called the little bit edema, which is swell the blood vessels. Due to the opening, due to the swelling of the blood vessel, the pores of the blood vessel become opens. So after the biting of the mosquito, we feel certain swollen parts are the skins. Salivary syringes that is fused to the floor of the hypopharynx at the interior end pump the saliva into the ventral salivary canal. This salivary canal penetrates saliva into the blood vessel of the host or the victim. The ventral salivary canal is formed by the juxtaposition of the maxillary stylets. Food canal lies, there is a dorsal salivary canal, food canal which is responsible to suck the blood from the blood vessel. And proboscis, exterior structure of the mosquito is commonly termed as the proboscis, which have the several different parts, which is commonly called the stylets. The stylus term mouth parts of the mosquito, which is actually used to piercing and enter the skin. This stylus not consists of one part, it consists of seven parts. Out of the seven, a pair of maxilla, a pair of the mandible, and the hypopharynx, pair of hypopharynx, and the labrum. All seven parts collectively form the stylus. All seven parts are penetrated into the blood vessel of the host. The tissue of the host, or tissue of the victim. Here, look here, piercing mouth part of the mosquitoes. I are represented here. This is the structure which is called the maxillae. These maxillae, these are the knife-like, knife to slide through the meat. The function of the maxillae is like that, as knife cut the meat into the small slices, into the small pieces. It is a sharp edges, it is a sharp structure which cut the tissue of the host to facilitate the penetration of its stylets other parts. This is the maxillary pulps. This is a sensory nature. This is called the labium. This labium is the outer sheath of the proboscis. It's formed the outer sheath of proboscis. This sheath folds back at the fascicles. Fascicle, that's the collection of the stylus, enter the flesh of the victim. That is the facility is to enter the stylus into the flesh of the victim. This is called the hypopharynx. It is a straw-like structure, pumping saliva into the victim. That is our straw-like structure. It is a connective with the salivary glands, salivary ducts. Saliva, due to this, is saliva. It is a straw-like structure through which saliva move into the blood vessels and into the tissue of the host. And this is the mandibles. Mandibles hold the tissue apart because when they are going to penetrate, they hold the tissue apart because the penetration of the saliva get easier. And this one is called the labrum. Labrum searching for a blood vessel beneath the skin, suck in the blood with the help of the hypopharynx. This is the labrum searching for the blood vessels, and also with the help of the hypopharynx, it is a penetrate and this penetrate in the blood vessel and suck in the blood. That is, it suck the blood from the blood vessels. At the terminal part of the labium, two sensory probes are existed. This is called the labium and labilla, which aids the mosquito into search for a food, a good place to bite. This is the sensory structure of the, which is present in the terminal part of the labium. This is the sensory structure. This is the labium. This is a responsible. This is a responsible to determine which is a better, a proper place at which part where the blood vessels are very near to the skin, and at that point they penetrate the stylus. This decides. If the skin is very thick, stylus cannot penetrate, they cannot bite at the point. So when mosquito is sitting at your hand, it can be ticking the stylus at your hands, because it wants to locate the actual position where that mosquito try to penetrate the stylus, the blood vessels, which is a very soft or easy place where blood vessels are very near. And here in this diagram, this is the outermost maxilla, this is the represents the mandible, this is the hypopharynx, this is the labrum, this is the labium. It is a sensory structure which is a decided where stylus have to penetrate. It is a sensory structure. Spawning mouth parts. Non-biting muscoid flies have a basal segment which is called the rostrum. This is a basal structure called rostrum. Here diagram is a very micro. It's not a big diagram. In the last slide, I will show you. It's a very clear picture. The rostrum made up of the part of the clypeus. It is made up of the clypeus and the basal portion of the maxilla. Clypeus and basal portion of maxilla. And the example of this category is a horsefly. Rostrum has distal fleshy and retractile proboscis. This is the distal part, is the fleshy proboscis and retractile proboscis, which can be retractile, which can be contract back, that represent a labium. Epically, this proboscis form a pair. There's a two half of spongy structure called labilla. This is the spongy structure which is called the labilla, and this labilla has a very minute channels. This channel is called the pseudotracheae, represented here with the white lines represented here in the labilla. This labilla composes several teeny channels called the pseudotracheae. These are formed by the combination of the labrum, epipharynx and the hypopharynx. These pseudotracheae are open, and such openings are ranged along the borders. These labilla are capable of taking up the exposed liquid just like the sponge. Sponges are having the multiple pores. You can take the example of a sponge. When you put a sponge at the any liquid material, the sponge can be the liquid can penetrate in the pores of this sponge. Like that, this is a spongy mouth parts. This type of the feeding, pre-digested fluid feeds, is referred to as the sponge type. This non-biting muscoid flies eject salivary secretion onto the solid food to digest them, so they are quite able to feed on such pre-digested fluid material as solid sugar, for example, dried honeydews, because this is a saliva which contains the digestive enzyme. These digestive enzymes pose on the solid food. That enzyme digested the food outside the body, then this digestive food can be taken up in the form of the dried honeydew. And represented the mouth parts of the horsefly. This is the compound eye, this is the antenna, this part is called the rostrum, and this part is called the clypeus. This is the para maxillipausensory nature. This is the hostellum. Pseudotracheae, which is represented with the white lines. This is the pseudotracheae. This perioral aperture, which is called labellum. This is a labellum. Siphoning mouthparts. Butterflies and the moths have elongated sucking tubes or the proboscis. This is formed of the galea of the maxilla. I also show the structure of the galea in the previous slides, but also explain here. This proboscis is formed by the galea of the maxilla. The remaining mouth parts are reduced or absent. They feed mainly on the floral nectars, butterflies, floral nectars. The proboscis, basically the preoral part is called proboscis. It's not used. It's kept coiled beneath and ahead. This proboscis, when butterfly is going to feed, this is the coil. This coiling of proboscis under the influence of the very fine contractile muscle fibers. Fine muscles responsible for the contraction. You can look when butterflies is going to sit at the flowers and tries to suck its nectar of the flowers. It elongates the proboscis, which is in normal circumstances. It is a coil beneath the head. Coiling and coiling minor mechanism of proboscis is by the action of the fine muscles. These fine muscles responsible for the coiling. Galea of the maxilla is responsible to form the proboscis. This is the inner canal, which is called the term as proboscis. This is suck the nectars of the flowers. The centini, this is a compoundi, this is the labrum and the maxillipalp and the labial palps. This is the proboscis and the black line represent the, this is the whole structure is called, this is the proboscis, and outer part of proboscis is the galea of maxilla. This is the galea maxilla and this is the galea of the maxilla. Here are represented a little bit actual diagram. This is the antennae, oscillus, compound eye, anterior tentorial plate, and the maxillary palps and the labial palps, coiled proboscis under the skin, which is under the head, which when it is not going to feed, here is going to collect the nectar of the flowers. I think you people can understand this lecture in a very precise way. I try my best to explain in a very simple, in a very easy way, and represented and explain my lecture with the help of a very specified diagram which clear your concept. And thank you very much. And the last, you can subscribe my channel for further videos. Thank you very much.